Yeah, Ephesians chapter 1. Does anybody have any comments to start with as we open up? Yeah, we only covered Ephesians 1, 1, 2, and 3. Mm-hmm. And tonight you'll catch up what we talked about this morning. So let's open in prayer. Lord, just thank you for your word, and I thank you for each person that's here. We just tell you we love you. We love you because you first loved us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What I want to go deeper on tonight, what did I do wrong? You might as well tell me now. Okay. All right, what I want to do tonight, I want to dive deeper at verse 3. Look at verse 3. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. This is the verse that we're going to unpack tonight. And if you have any questions, comments, you know, please ask, speak up, and we'll discuss it. But let's go back to verse 3. Let's start in verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us. And that's the entire book of Ephesians, talking about the blessings. We have received blessings from God. And the way that we receive blessings from God, all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, is this: in Christ. So we gain all the heavenly blessings because we're in Christ. What if you're not in Christ? You won't get any of these blessings. The entire book of Ephesians is talking about we as the body of Christ. We are now inherit the blessings because we're in Christ. Now look at verse 4, and I know we didn't discuss verse 4, but I want to show you something. You see that word according. You're going to see throughout the book of Ephesians his plan. That's what according to his plan, according to his purpose, and according to his will. You're going to see that throughout the first three chapters, especially. These three words come up over and over and over. Because the blessings we have, and it's been, you see verse 4, I know we're getting beyond 3, but I'm showing you some of the blessings in Christ. We're not getting into the blessings, but I'm showing you in Christ. And it, according, verse 4, according as to his plan, according to his purpose, and according to his will. We already know what his will is. What's his will? That we're saved. He wants everyone saved. That's his will. Everything that he does is for his will. It's part of his plan. He purposed in his plan and his will that he has made salvation available for everybody. So we have to be in Christ. And I did go past the first three verses because it's going to take so long to unpack these verses that I'm getting a little bit ahead. So I did jump into verse 4 because according as he has, look at what it says, chosen us. Now, I told you this morning what I want you to do is to start going through the Bible. Look at verse 3. He has blessed us. Verse 4, he has chosen us, in verse 4, that we. So I want you to look at the us and the we's. Look at verse 5, he's predestinated us. And look at verse 6, to the glory of his grace, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved. In verse 7, in whom, you're going to see in whom over and over and over. You're going to see in whom in verse 7, verse 11, you're going to see it in verse 13 and verse 13 twice. You're going to see in whom. That's always in Christ. In Christ. Now look at the we's and the us as we keep going. Verse 6, to the praise of his glory in his of his grace, wherein he has made us accepted into blood, in whom we have redemption. Verse 8, wherein he has abounded towards us, having made known unto us the mystery of his will. Matter of fact, in that verse, you'll see his will and the purpose. He purposed in himself. And if you keep going, look at verse 11. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance. Look at verse 12. That we should be to the praise of his glory. So you see, it's in us. Who's us? That's my question. Who's us? Who's the we? Who's receiving all of these blessings? Who are the we's? All right, go to chapter 3, verse 1. Chapter 3, verse 1. For this cause, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles. Who is he writing to? Gentiles. Who are the we and us? Gentiles, but in a more broad sense, it's the church, Christians. Everybody. And you're going to see that as we go. I'm just unpacking Ephesians for you is all I'm doing tonight. Yes. That's correct. All right. Good question. Let me show you. I just want to say yes. Look at Exodus 19. Exodus 19. And look at verse 6. I know Miss Rachel and I looked at this last week. Exodus 19:6 says, and ye, and it's talking to all of Israel, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. So he's telling Moses while he's up in Mount Sinai, getting the instructions, not just the Ten Commandments. You get that in chapter 20. He's getting the instructions of all the laws of the temple. He's up there for 40 days and 40 nights, a couple times. But here, he's telling Moses that the children of Israel are going to be a kingdom of priests, and they are to be a priest to the rest of the world. I think, go to Numbers chapter 8. So Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers 8. I think this has something to do with it too. Oh, but I think it might not, because this is where he's just telling them, I didn't choose you because you're larger than anybody else or because you're more than any number. Let's just look. Look at okay, this is where it's trying to see where I wanted to start. What verse? All right, look at verse 6. Verse 5. The Lord spake unto Moses, saying, take the Levites from the children of Israel and cleanse them. And thus shall they do unto them to cleanse them. So he tells them how to cleanse them. Why is he now choosing them? Look at verse 19. I have given the Levites as a gift to Aaron and to his sons from among the children of Israel to do the service of the children of Israel in the tabernacle of the congregation to make atonement for the children of Israel. So what he's doing here, let me tell you what happened in between Exodus and Numbers. The children of Israel have not obeyed God. So now he's not allowing all of them to be a kingdom of priests. Now he's choosing the line of Aaron. And that's going to be the Levite tribe. And he's going to use that one tribe as the priestly tribe. So I hope that makes sense. He wanted all of them, but they did not obey him. Matter of fact, in Exodus 19, where we were, Moses comes down to tell the children of Israel all that God said before he goes back up to get the commandments in chapter 20. He comes down, and in 19, they said, "All that the Lord has said, we will do." And they immediately abandoned that. They should have never said that. They lied. Okay, so anyway, yeah, the whole priestly line should have been all of the Israelites. So go back to Ephesians chapter number 1. And you see all of that God has written. He's written to us as the body of Christ. And we're going to get into that just a little bit right now. Still in verse 4. So according to his purpose, his plan, and his will, he has chosen us, or he has selected us, even the Gentiles. It's not just about the Jews. It's the whole world now. He has selected us, chosen us in him. In who? In Christ. Why did he choose us in Christ? Not because we're good, not because we deserve it, but because of grace. All because of grace. When did he choose us? Before the foundation of the world. I was going to put predestinated, but I ran out of room, so I couldn't put my D. Before the world began, he predestinated us. And I'm just going to throw this out there. I don't know how familiar you are with it, or even if you're not. If you're not, good. That's better. But this is where Calvinists get their sayings from. That before the foundation of the world, God chose us to be saved. The bad part is, you might not have been chosen. His grace is limited. This is their sayings, not mine. His grace is limited. His atonement is limited. Everything he does is limited. And he's only limited to a certain few because he's only chosen a certain few. They get their theology from this verse. And here's a problem. And this is where I want to help us as students of the Bible. You don't need to know Greek. You don't need to know Hebrew. You do need a good concordance. Let me tell you why. You can do this on your phone now. All you have to do is look up before the foundation of the world and see where it's mentioned in other places and see exactly what Paul is talking about. It's pretty easy once you do that. And once you compare Scripture with Scripture and what is he actually saying, he makes it so abundantly clear that what he has done is he has chosen us before the foundation of the world. He's predestined. He selected us for his will. He wanted us to be saved. So I want to get into that tonight just a little, if that's okay. And so the first place that I want to go is I want to go to 1 Corinthians. So just go to the left. Just a little bit. 1 Corinthians, and I'm going to start in chapter number 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And I think this will make it make so much sense that you'll say, how can they build their whole theology, their whole denominations around that when they're so wrong? How can they do it? All they have to do is open their Bible and read. And that makes them kind of arrogant. God chose us. He didn't choose you. That's right. Mm-hmm. And my question to them, because in school, you run into the professors and your presidents, and most of them believe that, what I'm telling you. That's what we're taught in school.
They are.
There's no question. They will tell you. We're part of the lucky ones. We're chosen.
Do they not understand or realize
They say that he's sovereign, which he is. He's sovereign, and you have no control over it. He's already chosen. All right. Now here's the problem, and that is a problem in their denomination, their religion, because years ago they reached way beyond that number of 144,000. So now you'll ask them, are you part of the 144,000? And they will tell you, no, we're not fortunate. You don't even have to ask them if they're going to be part of the 144,000. Are you going to heaven? No, we're not part of the fortunate ones. I said, that's what they say today. I said, well, let me tell you how you can. Or, if you go back and read Revelation 13, you can see which tribe do you come from? Because you know they chose 12 from each tribe to make the 144,000. 12 times 12 is 144. Which tribe are you from? What are you talking about? So now they're just going to be earth dwellers. But I want to show you something. Look at 1 Corinthians 2. There is no hope. Me neither. I talk to Jehovah's Witness a lot. I always start the same way because they approach you naturally. I said, I'm not interested in getting into a debate with you. Nobody wins. So why would I waste my time? Because if I can take the Bible, even your New World Translation, and I can show you you're wrong, will you change? And I'll tell them, if you can take my King James Bible and show me I'm wrong, I will change. Because this is right. This is our standard. So they will agree, yeah, we'll talk. And I'll show them things in our Bible and in theirs. I never saw that before, but they still don't change. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And here's the problem, because they use the same language as we do. But the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witness have the wrong Jesus. Because Jesus is not God. He is a God. He's not God. That's the wrong Jesus. Jesus is God. And I show them that so plainly. And let me just ask you a question. If you know the Ten Commandments found in Exodus 20, what are they? Thou shalt not have any other gods before me. So they know that's Jehovah God. What's the next one? You shall not bow down to them or worship them. You're not to make any graven images. So you just ask him, if Jesus is not God, he's just a God, why are you going to bow down to him one day? You just broke the commandments of your own God. Because every knee is going to bow to Christ. Everybody's going to confess he is Lord. That's in theirs too, by the way. They might have changed John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. They've changed that verse to He is a God. Yeah.
I appreciate that, because one of the things we're talking about, Calvinism, is a sect of the Baptist Church.
What, you mean here?
No, not here. You brought up Calvinism before.
Mm-hmm.
Don't they teach predestiny?
Who?
The Calvinists.
Oh, yeah.
That's
where they camp out. They only have two places in the Bible that will go, Romans 9 and here. And both of them, they take way out of context. And I, like I said, I was raised with them in schools. Every school I've gone to, except for maybe two, I've been to five different schools. Maybe two of them weren't Calvinist, but the rest are. I always ask them this. Can you tell me what 1 John 2:2 means? Because that's the verse I love. You know, he's the propitiation for our sins. Not ours only, sins of the whole world. Explain that to me. Then I ask them this. They do know this. What's God's will? I hope they know the Bible. They ought to know God's will. What's God's will for your life? What's God's will for everybody's life? You just quoted one of them from Peter just a minute ago. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. What about his own elect people, the Jews? They're elect, chosen by God. What about them? This is way off course, way off topic. Look at Ezekiel. Look at Ezekiel. So go past Jeremiah, Lamentations, then Ezekiel. 18. I never said I should have. Look at Ezekiel 18. The entire chapter talks like this, so hopefully you can go back and read it one day. But let's start in verse 19, Ezekiel 18, verse 19. Yet say ye, why? Doth not the Son bear the iniquity of the Father? When the Son hath done that which is lawful and right, and keepeth all my statutes, and hath done them, he shall surely live. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The Son shall not bear the iniquity of the Father, neither shall the Father bear the iniquity of the Son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. But if the wicked will turn from all of his sins that he has committed, that means to repent, and keep my statutes, and do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live, he shall not die. All of his transgressions that he has committed, they shall not be mentioned unto him. In his righteousness that he has done, he shall live. But look at what he says. Have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, saith the Lord God, and not that he should turn from his ways and live? Now he's going to keep going over this same thing over and over. He's wanting even his own chosen elect people to turn from their wicked ways, and if they turn, then he'll forgive them and they'll live. But if they don't turn, they'll die. Now, is he choosing them to go to heaven or hell? Or do they have a choice? All right, go to verse 24. But when the righteous turneth away from his righteousness and committeth iniquity and doth according to all the abominations that the wicked man doth, shall he live? Answer is no. All of his righteousness that he has done shall not be mentioned in his trespass that he has trespassed, and his sins that he has sinned in them. Shall he die? Yet you say, the way of the Lord's not equal. See, it wouldn't be equal if he says, okay, I choose you to live, you to die. No, he's telling them, I am equal. You turn from your wicked ways and you'll live. But if you don't, I've given you my statutes, I've given you my law. Here's what I expect out of you. But if you continually go against what I want, you're not going to live. Please turn, do what's right, and you're going to live. He says it over and over and over. Look at verse 31. Let's see how this chapter ends. Verse 31 and 32. Cast away from you all of your transgressions, whereby you have transgressed, and make you a new heart and a new spirit. For why will you die, O house of Israel? I have no pleasure in the death of him that dieth, saith the Lord God. Wherefore, turn yourselves and live. Sounds pretty plain, doesn't it? Repent. We could go to chapter 33. Go to chapter 33. You're in Ezekiel. Look at verse 11. 33:11. Say unto them, as I live, saith the Lord, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Do you think God still has death? Pleasure in the death of the wicked? I don't think so. Let's keep reading. But that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn ye from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel? He's pleading with them to turn. He's not saying, I've chosen you to die, I've chosen you to live. No, he's pleading with them. So let's go back to, I hope you went to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Is that where you're at? He is long-suffering and patient. Yes, sir. But I'll show you even more proof in just a second. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Look at verse 7. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. Didn't that sound kind of like the same, before the foundation of the world? Look at the next verse. Which none of the princes of this world knew. Who are the princes? It's probably the spiritual wickedness, the fallen angels. I don't know. It could be the princes of Rome. I don't know. But anyway, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. That's right. They killed Christ and they thought they won. When they killed Christ, what happened? He rose again. They lost. That's part of the mystery. They knew before the foundation of the world, they didn't know that Christ was going to rise again. They should have known that part. That was written. But he did it so that you and I could be saved. And if they would have known that, we're saved by his death, burial, and resurrection, they would have never put him to death. So where was that? It was before the foundation of the world. Before the foundation of the world, God already knew, he already predestinated that we could be saved by the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Before the foundation of the world, what was known? That Christ would have to die. It makes it more clear as we go. Go to the right to Colossians 1. Colossians 1, just go to the right. Verse 25. Colossians 1, 25 and following. And what we're looking at is before the foundation of the world. What was known? Paul says, wherefore, I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. So first of all, what God showed Paul fulfilled the rest of the word of God. We have everything we need now. Verse 26, even the mystery, but here's what I wanted you to see, which has been hid from the ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints. That's Christians. Verse 27. To whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. I hope you see that. It's, what is it? It's the gospel. We have the hope of Christ before the foundation of the world. It's not that he chose us before the foundation of the world, who's going to live and who's going to die, who's going to know him and who isn't. What was chosen is that the whole world could be saved through him. I'm going to show you some more. We're not done. I'm going to make it clear by the time we get done. Look at 2 Timothy. So go to the left. Go to the right. 2 Timothy chapter 1. In verse 9, let's read verse 9. Who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus, when? Before the world began. In verse 9, what you'll see is the gospel. Look at it again and look at the gospel. He saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose. So it's not according to our works. In other words, you did nothing for salvation, but it was according to his purpose. What was his purpose? His will and purpose was for everyone to be saved. And that's why he sent Jesus Christ. You see at the end of that? And grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. That's the gospel. Keep reading. But is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death, hath brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. That's what it's all about, the gospel. What's the gospel? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. What was known before the foundation of the world? That Jesus Christ would come and die for the world so that the world could be saved through him. Let's read another verse, verse 11. Wherefore, I am appointed a preacher and an apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles. Why is Paul called to be a preacher? Because he's called to give out the gospel which saves, all the way back to verse number 9. He's the gospel that saves us. He is here to be a minister of the gospel because he wants everyone to know the gospel so they can have salvation. That's why he's preaching. That's why God chose him as an apostle. I hope that makes a little bit more sense. All right, go to the right. Let's go to Titus. I have to only turn two pages. Titus chapter 1. Let's start in verse 2. Let's just read verse 2 and 3. In hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised before the world began. What did he promise before the world? Predestinated before the foundation of the world. Before the world began, he predestinated. What did he promise us? Eternal life. Before the world began, He knew that when he created mankind, that he would offer mankind eternal life. He knew that the life was only found in his son Jesus. He also knew when he created man that if he gave them a choice, they would turn from him. Every one of us have. God did not create evil. He's not the author of it. He didn't create it. What he created was eternal life. He wants everybody to have life. Unfortunately, Satan wants, he's here to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants you dead. Christ has come to give you life. Why is Paul preaching? He wants you to have life. Why do we preach? We want people to have life. All right, let's read it again. 2, and then we'll go into 3. In hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised before the foundation, before the world began, but hath in due times manifested his word through preaching, which is committed unto me according to the commandment of God our Savior. So he's given it through the preaching of his word. Let me see where I want to go next. Okay, let's just go back to Ephesians 1. I think that's good enough. I've shown you a lot of verses about before the world began. Something else just came to my mind. Let me show you something else real quick. I don't know how much time I have. A little bit. Let's do this. Look at Matthew 25. You remember Matthew 25, where we're going, is where God is separating the lost and the saved. The sheep's on the right hand, the goat's on the left hand. You remember that? Okay, let's go there. Matthew 25. All right, start in verse 33. And he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on his left. Verse 34. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Look at that. That's not from before the foundation of the world. That's since the foundation of the world. This is Israel, and God has chosen them, and there's going to be some that are saved and some that are lost. Let me just show you some other places let's go to Luke chapter 1. I'm showing you these things because these are in contrast to before the world began. Luke 1. That's all I'm showing you for is contrast. This is not before the foundation. This is since the foundation of the world. Luke 1, verse 70. Start in verse 69. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. That's Jesus Christ. As he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, this is the Old Testament, which have been since the world began. I have more that I could show you, but I think you get the picture. What we were looking at earlier, before the foundation of the world, was Jesus is going to die for the world, not just for a certain few, but for every single person. And that wasn't plan B. God had promised that before the foundation of the world. He knew before the foundation of the world, his son Jesus would come and die for you, for us, for the church. And who's the church? Whoever trusts in him. It doesn't matter now if you're Greek, Jew, or Gentile. It doesn't matter if you're rich or poor. It doesn't matter if you're bond or free, male or female. If you're trusting Christ, you're in the body. All right, we're still in verse 4. We're still trying to unpack it. If you trust in Christ, and remember, according, he has a purpose, a plan, and his will, and that was before the foundation of the world, and look at how we should be. Holy and without blame. So we're going to be holy and without blame. Now, let's just look at that real quick, and then we'll go. I know we were just in Colossians, but let's look at Colossians chapter 1 again. Colossians 1, 17 and 18. And he, talking about Jesus, is before all things, and by him, Jesus, all things consist. I'm thankful he's holding it together. Everything is here because of him, and without him, not anything that is made that was made. I'm glad that everything is held by him. The earth is spinning on nothing, in the middle of nothing. Verse 18, and he is the head of the body, the church. Told you that this morning. Colossians tells you Jesus is the head, we're the body. Ephesians tells you you're the body. So he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he, Christ, might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him, Jesus, should all the fullness dwell, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him, Jesus, to reconcile all things unto himself, by him, I say, whether there be things on earth or in heaven, and you, that's us, that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death. Look at how he's going to present you. To present you holy, unblameable, unreprovable in his sight. Amen. That's exactly what your response should be. Not because we've done anything to deserve it. Not because he even chose us to do it. No, because of his son Christ and his death on the cross. Now, when he, you see how you are? You're perfect. Say, no, I'm not. In his sight, you are, because he sees you how you are in Christ. You are in Christ. You might be in this sanctuary right now. We're in this building, all right? You're in Christ. And in Christ, now you are part of the elect, Miss Rachel. Now in Christ, you are holy and perfect and unblameable. Because you are in Christ. And that's the only reason that you or I could be that way. I'm trying to think if I should go any further. Yeah, let's just go a little bit further. Go down to verse 25. Wherefore, I am made a minister. Here's Paul again. I'm a minister. I've been preaching. Why? Because now if you trusted in Christ, you can be made perfect. I want you to have the inheritance that he's got for you. I'm made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which has been hid from ages, from generations, but now it's made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of his glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. But 28 is where I wanted you to get to. Whom we preach, warning every man, teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Jesus Christ. You're going to be perfect in Jesus. And he's letting you know, you're going to be presented perfect in Jesus. Let's just do one more. I'll do two more. Because I'm going to show you one of my favorite verses. I have a lot of them. Or go to Ephesians 5. That's not my favorite verse. The last one's going to be one of my favorites. Ephesians 5. You remember when They're telling about husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church. Wives, submit to your own husbands. All right, that's Ephesians 5. That's where I want to go. Ephesians 5, look at verse 25 and following. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify it, cleanse it by the washing of the water of the word. Verse 27, that he, that's Christ, might present to it to himself a glorious church, not having spot nor wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. He's been talking about marriage, but now he's switching from marriage to the church because they're the same. Last one, Jude, verse 24. One of my favorite verses. Jude is right before Revelation. So you have 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, Jude, Revelation. It's only one chapter. So don't ask me what chapter. Twenty-four is kind of like the doxology for Jude, second to last verse. Now unto him, that's God or Christ, that's able to keep you from falling. And look at what he's going to do. Christ is going to do this. He's going to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceedingly joy. That ought to get you excited too. Why should that get you excited? Let me tell you why. All right, Brother Artie, let me use you for an example. You just passed away. The whole world's mourning. The preacher's going to get up and preach and say how great of a guy you are. He's in heaven and all that stuff. You don't know if he's in heaven or hell. But we're going to preach him into heaven. It makes everybody happy, comfortable. But what really happens? When you take your last breath, it's instant you're with Christ. Amen. Instant. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Instantaneous. What happens? This is what I believe because of reading his word. He doesn't send a death angel after him. He sends Jesus. Jesus himself comes and gets you and presents you to God. He does it a couple ways. He does it, first of all, with exceeding joy, because he can present you faultless. Could you imagine that day when he, Jesus, here he is, here's Artie, he's trusted in you as our Savior. He's trusted in me as a Savior. I'm presenting him to you because he's faultless. He's perfect. Matter of fact, he can't even enter into heaven unless he's perfect, because he's been clothed with the righteousness of Jesus Christ, and he's doing it with exceeding joy because his death on the cross just saved you. And he's going to present you to God faultless. And you're going to be in heaven forever and ever worshiping him. Can you imagine that day? It beats the alternative, doesn't it? When you're standing before him and he opens up the books, and then the book of life, knowing you're not even in there. But other books, I believe, are the books of the law. There's 613 laws. Some people say 615, but there's a lot of laws. And you've broken every one of them. And you're going to realize when you are standing in front of holiness and righteousness that you don't measure up. And what's he going to do? Depart from me, I never knew you. What are you going to say? But Lord, I've gone to church every Sunday and I taught Sunday school and I've been a good person and look at what I've done. Lord, I've prophesied in your name, and I've cast out demons in your name, and in your name I've done many wonderful works. And he says, depart from me, I never knew you. Never knew you. It's not like you lost your salvation. I never knew you. I never had a relationship with you. Sure beats the alternative when he says, I'm going to present you to God, and you're going to be faultless, and I'm going to do it with exceeding joy, because I died for you. You were picked up out of hell, and you brought to heaven, and you're going to be up here with us forever. Forever and ever and ever. Yes, sir.
They turn away. All their righteous works will not be counted, right?
That's right.
So we're talking about people that think they're righteous, but they're calling them righteous at the time. Are you talking about people that were actually righteous that turned away? So I was just trying to reconcile that, put that in perspective.
Look at Isaiah 64:6. Somebody open it up and read Isaiah 64:6. And I know we have to go, but just want you to see something.